let's start with the tutorial. We have Ehsan giving the tutorial, and this will be the third one, and we'll have one more at the Hackmap menu, which is at 7:30. So let's get this thing started.
We'll be walking through pandas. This will be fairly hands-on in the sense that you can follow along with me by all these examples. There are a couple of ways in which you can do that. If you've got pandas installed on your machine, then just follow the steps as we go along. I've set up two instances of IPython notebook online as well. You can go to 175.41.189.14:, either 8000 or 8888. And I suggest you create, if you are creating a notebook, I suggest you create one with your name so that you know which one it is and don't Google number other people's notebooks. It's 175.41.189.140.
Or can I just use it on...
Yeah, please use it locally if you can. That's the best option. Now, the way to start, firstly, let's start with what pandas is. Pandas is a data analysis library. This is going to be a pure data analysis session. There's no way we'll have time to cover this and visualization using pandas. Pandas visualization capabilities are not necessarily the best. So you've covered D3, you've covered R. Both of them are superior to pandas from a data visualization perspective. So we'll be covering this from purely an analysis perspective. The answer to the question, why would you want to use pandas for data analysis, is because A, at the moment, it appears to be the best package on Python, which in turn appears to be the best or most popular programming language for data analysis. This is if you, in many respects, are quite a good one as well. If you compare this with R, then put it this way, there is no doubt that every single feature that pandas offers is also available in R, and there are enough features in R that are not available in pandas. So from a feature set perspective, R is superior. If you're a statistician, you love R and its documentation. It's just made for analyzing statistics. If you're a programmer, you may find it a lot tougher to break through. R does have a steep learning curve, and that's something that's been a challenge for a lot of people. Pandas, on the other hand, is simpler, relatively speaking. In absolute terms, pandas is a bit tough. But compared, so between D3, R, and pandas, there's no doubt that pandas is easiest. At least for me, I suspect that you'll have a similarly easy experience. So what we do is, first, on your local machine, if you want to start off with IPython, all you have to do is say IPython. Sorry, I have a bigger constructor. You say IPython space notebook. Now, IPython is something that comes as it's an add-on package to Python. It provides interactive capability. IPython notebook is a web-based console. So when I run IPython notebook, my browser starts, goes to the URL where I can create notebooks and start working with it. This is also what is running at the URL that I mentioned earlier, 175.41.189.140, with a variety of, with either port 8000 or 8888. I'm going to be running it on the local machine just in case the internet gets cut off. I don't want the session to be stopped. But you can feel free to either run it on your local machine or on the internet, whatever suits you. Now, we'll be creating a new notebook. There's a link here. A notebook is a program for all practical purposes. Out here, I can type in any Python command and it gets executed. So I can say 1 plus 1 and not enter, but shift enter. That executes it. Enter will just add a new line. So you can type multiple lines. I can say print 1 plus 1, print 2 plus 2, etc. And it prints 2 and 4, one after another. You can type a sequence of commands. So that's it in terms of setup. We have a couple of options in terms of what we do in this session. We can either play around with cricket data, or we can play around with elections data. And I leave the choice entirely to you. It's either the 2012 elections data, assembly elections, or all of the test cricket data that exists till date. Both data sets are publicly available. So how many votes for election? Seems to be the majority. Cricket?
I need to run as.
I'll start with cricket. there is a file that's already available. But I'll tell you, for those who don't have, go to files.grammar.com/, those who are running it locally, go to files.grammar.com/data. And there's a file called testbatting.csv.bz to download it. Grammar.com/data. Grammar. Yeah, incidentally, I am Anand. Hello. Chief Data Scientist of Grammar. And that's one of our things. If you can, unzip the BZIP2 file. If you don't have it, don't worry. Pandas can handle BZIP2 files just fine. For the rest of you, what you could do is the rest of you, I'll walk you through it as we go along. I'm going to download this file, testbatting.csv.bz2, on the local machine. Actually, I don't know why I'm doing that. I already have it on the local machine. And I'm going to unzip it. Now, let's open this file and see what it contains. Maybe I ought not even do this. Let me not do this. On IPython, I've got this file on my local, in the current directory. So if I say ls, it gives me a listing of all of the files in the current directory. One of them is this testbatting.csv. Now, here's the first command that you're going to try. It's import pandas as pd. The module pandas is imported with the name pd. PD just saves you some typing effort, and it's the convention. So when you run this, pandas is now imported. We are going to load this file testbatting.csv, and I'll pause until all of you are able to load it, and then we'll start playing around with it. The way to do it is, you say data is equal to, or any variable for that matter, but I'm going to be using data, is equal to pd.read_csv of this file. And shift enter. At this point, data is loaded.
How do you directly handle
BZ2? If you have a BZ2 file, say, comma, the options are as follows. You know, a whole bunch of options are listed here. Somewhere you see a compression is equal to null. You can say compression is equal to BZ2. And if you do that, it will have the BZ2.
On the online version,
On the online version, it is exactly the same command that I typed before. It is in your current folder. So if you run this, it ought to work. It, at least it should not report an error. If I type in a file name that does not exist, it will report an error like this. Yeah.
How do we load this URL? It's not working on PKG.
175.. On the local one, it's usually 127.0.0.1:8.8.8.
Yeah, I'm running a VM actually, so still it will be on 8.8.8.
If
you need to do a port forwarding for that.
Okay. Or just IP colon.
Give it a shot. If it doesn't work, try the online version.
Okay.
Yes.
IP for that
here. 175.41.189.140. Anyone has issues loading the file?
No. Damn it.
If you just say pd.read_csv test-batting.csv.
It has to be in the same directory to load.
Yes, and if you're running on the server, I put it in the same directory. If not, you can type in the full path. Yeah, so just say if you're on a Windows machine, then use /. So you can say /. In my case, it's in /test.
Don't use the tilde for the home directory.
You can.
Yeah, probably not yet.
No, you can. You can include the chrome.
For the encrypted file, what do you just add?
You mean compressed? If it's compressed, then say comma compression equals whatever the compression is. And not whatever the compression is. You can suppose GZ, and BZ. In this case, it's a BZ2 file. anyone has not been able to load the file yet? Give it a minute. Incidentally, it doesn't have to be on the local machine. It could be loaded from a URL directly. You can use URL open and load it from there. In fact, we do that for the next set. For the elections data set, we load it directly from the ECA website. Let's hope and pray that we don't bring the site down. Files.graminer.com/data. That's graminer.
Network is run.
Yeah.
can you put that on that file server?
I wouldn't have access to it.
Okay.
Maybe you can share those USB sticks and pass it around between those who have it. That might be a good start.
No,
somebody who has already downloaded it could put it there and copy.
That is okay for this. I don't have it.
They're floating around.
Who has the files over here?
Hello?
This is admin.csv.bz unless you already expect this. So then the same is in the compass. No, they're not going to be.
Let's just carry on. Let's take a quick poll. Hands of those who have not managed to load the file yet. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. I'm going to continue and hopefully you'll be able to catch up. So now we've got this file. It's sitting in this variable data. The question is, what can we do with it? What kind of analysis can we do with it? Before we answer that, obviously you've got to know what is in that data. So let's try and see what happens when you print data. So if I just say data, it says the following. It says it's class pandas.code.frame.dataframe. Let's pause here for a minute. When you read a CSV file, it loads it as a class called dataframe. A dataframe is like a table. There are two other similar classes of importance in pandas, a series, which is like an array, and a column, which is like a three-dimensional thing. Okay. Think of it as multiple worksheets. I've never used panel. Mostly we'll stick with series and data frames. When you load a CSV file, by default, it puts it into a data frame because it often has rows and columns. Now, read CSV has a huge number of options, beginning with how many lines do you want to skip at the beginning, what are the data types, and so on. Usually, it does what you think it ought to do, just loads the file, and does some basic type conversion. Basic, not very advanced. It's got 83,369 entries, which represent each one of the innings ever played in test cricket. That's how many innings there were until day before yesterday. And we have the player, the country, the minutes. I have no idea what that is.
How long has been batted?
Okay, duration. Okay. Number of runs, balls faced, four sixes, strike rates. Oh, number of innings, okay. Opposition, which country they play against, ground, and the start date. But this is not quite the same as seeing the data. Can you see the data? Sort of. Firstly, if you want to see what methods this supports, now the data frame object supports a number of methods with the dot as a namespace. So you say dot, press tab in IPython, you'll see a bunch of things. Firstly, you'll see some attributes: country, force, ground, ins, minutes, opposition, etc. You'll notice that these are all available as columns. So which means that I can type in any column here data.ground. And it will show me the values for the ground. In this case, it's starting with Melbourne, it stops in the middle, and then towards the end, it's series of innings at Leeds. Or data.sixes. So mostly zeros with a few ones and twos scattered around. So first, you can get the column directly. There are other ways of getting a column. You can treat this like a dictionary. So you can say open square bracket, close square bracket, and within that put whatever you want. So if I said sixes, I'll get exactly the same thing. Data, I'm going to make it a little smaller so that you can see the... So if you say data of sixes, you'll see the same thing as data dot sixes. Now this obviously is helpful if your column titles have spaces in them. Otherwise, there's no way of putting those in. That apart, there are a number of other useful methods. Align, all, append, blah, blah, blah. It's a huge list. What we're going to do is go through a few of these today. And as we go along, I'll point you to the important, which ones are important, which ones you probably need to remember. One that you'll need to remember and use a lot when you're playing around with the data is head, which does what you might think. It shows you the head, the top portion of the data set. So in this case, it's shown us something that is not too different from what you saw earlier, except that it just shows the first five entries. It's still not, it's not the same as seeing the data. Now the reason for that is, when the data goes to white, Panda says, I'm not going to show it to you the normal way. I'm going to show it to you this kind of column structure so that you get an overview of what's happening and don't get confused. But what we can do is, say, pd.set option. Now, pd.set option has a number of options internally. You can say, display.chop threshold is equal to something, display.callheader underscore justify is equal to something, etc. The ones that we want are line width and max columns. We want to tell Pandas, look, it's okay, even if the line goes up to, say, 200 characters, show it to me. If the columns go beyond, say, 20 columns, it's still fine, just show it to me.
How do you guys show it to me?
There are, at almost any point, you can press tab in Pandas. So if I say PD, sorry, not Pandas, in IPython, if you say PD dot and press tab, you get to see everything that's under the PD namespace. The function that we are looking for...
When you actually took the details of what the function can take, that tool.
Yeah, so that comes when you go inside the function. In this case, I'm saying data, pd dot set underscore option, open bracket. After the open bracket, I press a tab, it gets a tooltip. Now, this tooltip is pretty versatile one. I press tab once, it shows me the options at a summary level. Press tab twice, it expands it a little more. Press tab the third time, it will keep it there even after I start typing a bit for 10 seconds. So the first option that we're going to set is display dot line display dot line underscore width.
Yes. Continue.
And I'm going to set that to 200. I'm also going to set display dot max columns to 20. Give that a shot. Display.line underscore width is 200. Max underscore columns is 20. That's again a display dot.
What are the default values?
Sorry?
What is the default values for max column? 80.
Sorry, how much?
Must be 80.
No, max columns is more like 5 or 10 or something.
Columns.
Line width is probably 80. And now if I say data.head, I get a much better formatted display. And here's when we're going to start looking at what we want to do with this data set. We'll pause for a minute. Let me catch up with this.
Okay.
folks, sorry, if you're not getting results on the server, it might be, it's just too busy. If you ever see an asterisk, so out here, you see the command number that's being executed, 14, 15, etc., which roughly represents this is the 14th time you press shift enter or control enter. If you see an asterisk there, that means that it's still in the process of executing. On the server, see a whole bunch of asterisks. So, sorry, you may just have to. I thought two servers would suffice, but maybe not. Yeah, I'll just try shutting down that notebook and restarting that notebook. So now, we've got the player, the country, minutes, blah, blah, blah. What question would you like answered?
Who spent the maximum time and scored the least?
Who spent the maximum time and scored the least? Let's note these down. Now, who spent the maximum time and scored the least? The good part about IPython notebook is you can treat this like a markdown editor. So I can change the cell type somewhere to markdown. I know the keyboard shortcut. Unfortunately, I don't know how to
say it.
Cell markdown. So that converts it to markdown. It's easier to type the keyboard shortcut if you're familiar with it, which is Control M M. To see the list of keyboard shortcuts, press Control M H, and that's all the keyboard shortcuts that there are. Eventually, you will get used to them. For now, you can use the menu. And since it's markdown, I'm just going to put that as a third level heading. Okay, that's one question. Anything else we'd like to see?
Who hit the most sixes?
Who hit the most sixes in Test cricket? Any guesses on who that is?
Who's played the most?
Okay, let's leave it at that for now. Okay. Anything else?
On the game that had the last most number of runs scored.
Okay. Which game had the most runs scored? Go on.
What is the highest difference between the runs scored and I mean like the runs average and the bowling average, the batting average and the bowling average?
Okay, we have only the batting data.
Oh, okay.
Let's do a couple more.
Highest percentage of runs scored by a single batsman in a game.
What do you mean percentage?
Like if team scored 150, out of that one guy scored 100.
Okay. Who has scored the highest percentage of runs scored? Okay. Last question.
Which person has got more duck? The person has scored more duck.
Okay. Max ducks. We do 6 number. And
which country's player has the most strike? Better strike rate.
Which country's player? You mean which country has the highest strike rate?
Yeah.
Okay. Which country has the highest strike rate? Okay. Let's see how many of these we can. No, I mean we can answer all of these fairly quickly. Let's go through these. We'll go through them in the same order. Or no, I may reshuffle the order depending on which one is simpler for you to understand which one is tough. Let's start with who spent the maximum time and scored the least. So that begs the question: how do we find out who spent the maximum time? Now, I'm going to add, now, we can figure out who spent how much time by looking at data of minutes. data of minutes. That tells us who spent the, for each innings, it gives us information on the number of minutes that were spent. Do you see any problems with this? Okay, let's do this. First, let's try and find out what is the maximum duration of time that anyone ever sat in a match. Okay. So to do that, data of minutes dot, let me press tab. Okay, that doesn't work. Let's just say minutes is equal to data dot of minutes. And minutes dot tab. We've got a whole bunch of functions. Let's see if min and max exist. Yeah, min exists. Max also exists. If I say minutes of max, it says 99 minutes. Do you see It's text, exactly. Now, why do you think it's text?
Because of the code. Some cases you don't have timesets coded by dash.
And that is the underlying reason, yes. So, you can see that it had codes, and the reason it probably is treating it as text is because we have these hyphens. So, we've got to convert it to numbers. Let's start by looking at the type conversion function. So, the second function that I'm telling you about after head is asType. Now, asType takes a data type as input. In this particular case, let us assume that the minutes are always integers, and I'm going to put int. If we thought they could be float, I would put float. I'm going to say int, and it says invalid little for long with base 10, and it says hyphen. So, I don't know if you saw that. Hyphen is not a valid int, so we've got to remove these hyphens. Let's do that. So the next function that you've got to look at is replace. Minutes.replace, I can replace anything with anything. So let us assume, for simplicity's sake, that anything that's a hyphen is going to be replaced with a zero. So now you've got a bunch of zeros here. Now this I can then do an as type of int. Let's see if that works. Okay, now note here that right at the bottom it's saying d type int 32. If I did not do the as type of int, it instead showed us, remove the as type of int, it instead showed object. By default, pandas stores stuff as integers, floats, or pretty much any other type is treated as an object, and it has the ability to store a variety of objects. So, dot as type of it. Now we've got, let me replace minutes itself with that. Now let's look at the max of this, dot max. We have somebody who stayed on the crease for 970 minutes. Question is, how do we figure out who this was?
There should be some kind of an index
function. Absolutely. And this brings us to another fairly important feature of pandas, that data frames, series, etc., they also have an index. Now this takes a bit of time getting used to. The initial concept is quite easy. You'll find that for the first month or so you play around swimmingly with indices, except that a few things don't work and you just ignore them. Then you'll find that it's a whole lot more subtler than you imagine. But for now, let's just start with how one goes about creating indices. Before we do that, I'm going to do a few things. We spent some time converting minutes to integers. I want to preserve this, and I want to preserve this in the data frame. I want to make sure that data of minutes is an integer, not the string that it was.
So you committed up to that point.
Exactly. So sort of committed up to that point by saying data of minutes, which we took it from, is equal to minutes.replace of this. Now, I was using this variable minutes is equal to data of minutes just so that I can press minutes dot and press tab for simplicity's sake. If this were regular code, this is how I would write it. Data of minutes is equal to data of minutes dot replace hyphens with zeros dot as type of int, and I chop off the max. We are not looking to store the max, we are looking to store the values themselves. When I do that, I get nothing really, it just has put it into data. From this point onwards, data of minutes is an integer. Prior to this point, it was a string. Now, let's take a look at data. Let's look at data.head. What would we like the index to be? Presumably, we're interested in the player's name, so we might want the index to be the player. However, for a given player, there would be multiple innings at the very least. Someone would have played thousands of innings. So we don't quite have.
We can use the internal pointer, the zeros, ones.
We can use the internal pointer, exactly. So by default, pandas provides an index which does not have a title. That's 0, 1, 2, 3, etc. So question is, how do we retrieve this index? Let me show you a number of ways by which we can do that. Now, if I want, one way of doing this is by filtering. I can say, and this is the next concept that I'm going to be teaching you. You can say data of, and put in a condition here. Depending on this condition, the output will be a filtered list. For example, I can say, show me all of those rows where the players played for more than 900 minutes. Well, firstly, let's do this. Data of minutes, that gives me, data of minutes, gives me the number of minutes. Data of minutes greater than 900 for each row gives me a true or a false. It applies this condition across the entire series and gives me true if it is true for that row or false if it is false for that row. Now this true or false, I can put this inside square brackets. Say data of minutes greater than 90. And what this does is returns all of those innings where the players play for more than 900 minutes. And there's only one such innings. Hanif Muhammad in 1958 against West Indies. Which sort of already gives us our answer. That's one way of doing this. And if I wanted the index from this, that's 17710. We are not going to get into how to get that index programmatically, just give it 5 minutes. So now filtering is extremely powerful. If I wanted to see, let's pick something else. Who had more than 6 sixes in a match? Sixes is greater than 6. Okay, that's... What do you think is going wrong here? It's effectively listing 83,369 rows. Say, practically everyone has hit more than 6 sixes. I have no clue. Let's try and find it.
Data type.
Most likely data type. Let's find it. But first I'm going to say data of 6 is greater than 6. It's saying true for everything. Okay? Data of 6 is D type object. Okay? That's because hyphens again. So what we did for minutes, let's copy and do it for 6s as well. In the same block. And now if you see data of 6s, that's in 32. That's good. Now let's say data of 6 is greater than 6. And there were a reasonable number. Quite a few actually. How do we find out how many there were? How do you find out the length of an array?
Length.
Which works just fine with the data frame. Now in a data frame, you could say length is columns or rows. By default it's rows. If you want the number of columns, there are other ways of finding that out. So length of this says that there were 22 innings in which there were more than 6 sixes. And if I wanted 10 sixes, there were only 3 innings. Which is all very fine, but what if I wanted a histogram? That is, I wanted to see how many innings had, how many innings had 0 sixes, how many innings had 1 six, 2 sixes, etc. There's something for that. That's value underscore counts. I don't even know if it's a function or an attribute. We just need data of sixes. Dot value underscore counts as a function. So that says there was one innings with 10 sixes, 12 sixes, 2 innings with 8 sixes, 2 innings with 11 sixes, and so on. This isn't sorted. It looks from this list that the highest number of sixes that were scored in the match is at the bottom of the list, which is 10. But this is in fact sorted in descending order of the number of innings, which is a problem because we would ideally like it in ascending order of number of sixes, which is possible as a function called sort underscore index. At this point, I'm going at a pace where you may not be able to remember the functions. That's all right. The ones that you needed to remember, I've already mentioned. These you will get just by exploring the API. So now it's sorted by the index, and it's sorted as 0 to 12. You can see how many, which is the maximum number of sixes, 12 sixes. And now you know how to figure out who hit or which one innings had 12 sixes. So let's do that. Could you tell me what I need to type to figure out who hit 8 6 6s, 12 6s.
Data of filter data 6 is equal to 12.
Data of
filter data 6
is equal to 12. Or greater than 11 or equal to 12.
Greater than 11 or equal to 12. Okay, let's see, equal to 12. So that was Wasim Akram against Zimbabwe. We still haven't quite answered the question, who spent the maximum time and scored the least, though we've learned a few other things about Wasim Akram and others. Now, how do we figure out how they scored the least? That's just the number of runs, right? So let's see what data of runs shows us. Now we have a bunch of problems. We've got a DNB, we've got a star at the end. There's no way we'll be able to easily convert these into numbers. Now, I guess you know what the star at the end means, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Not out. Which is useful information. I don't quite want to toss that out either. I would rather preserve that in a separate column. And then in the runs column, I'll knock that off. So we'll have a separate column for not out term. D and B may be useful information, but there are other ways of preserving. So let's first start by getting rid of the DNB. Now, there is a value called NaN. NaN effectively stands for not a number and is a common representation for missing data. Supposing I have data, rainfall data for the months of January, February and March. Okay. So let's say the rainfall data was 20, 30 and 40. I'm going to take all of these markdown things and move them elsewhere. It's a bit jarring. Supposing I never measured it for February, it doesn't make sense for me to put a zero here. That would indicate that there was no rain in that particular month, and zero is a value that is distinct from saying I did not measure it. In a CSV file, I would have just left this as black. I would just put nothing on it. The trouble is that does not translate well into Python syntax. So the equivalent of leaving something black is numpy.nan. In fact, I think pd.nan may also work.
NaN is native in Python, right?
Okay, NaN is not defined directly in Python. It is, you get a NaN error and stuff like that, but NaN by default does not exist in Python. Python to some extent understands the concept of NaN, but does not directly have, unlike JavaScript, a number value called NaN. And NumPy introduces that. NumPy, incidentally, is a library that's sitting below Pandas and does most of the low-level lifting. And it's written in C, makes life a little bit faster, so which is what makes Pandas reasonably faster. So what I can say is 10, numpy.nan, 30. And that indicates that it's a missing value. What I would now like to do, therefore, is replace all of the DNBs with NANs rather than zero runs. It is zero runs, but we just preserve that information by saying data of runs is equal to data of runs dot replace DNB with zero. NumPy.nan. And let's see if we can convert this to an int now. Not quite. Problem is there are these stars at the end. Okay. So we've got to get rid of the stars at the end. What we can do is take that information of regarding the stars and put it into a separate column. Now, how do we do that? Pandas has a series of string functions. I can say, let's say runs is equal to data of runs. Now, runs dot str dot gives us a series of functions. For any of these columns, if you say dot str dot a set of functions, they execute functions on string columns. It has cat, which is concatenate, center, contains, count, decode, encode, ends with, and ends with looks promising.
Yes.
We want to see if it ends with a star. So if it ends with a star, ends with a star. Now that's a true or false. Just to check. Now the first one is true, second one is false. Let's print runs. First one is true, second one is false. So runs.str.ends with. Now I can put this in as a new column. To add a column in pandas, you use the same syntax for modifying a column. You say data of not out is equal to. Now not out is a new column, I just coined it right now. And assign a series to that column. So now, data of not out is this particular value. I'm going to move it up along with the rest of the stuff. So now that we have the not out information, we can afford to discard it from the runs column. Now how do we do that? Let's do replace. We just replace asterisk. Except here, we are not replacing an entire value. We are replacing only a portion of a string's value. So dot replace replaces an entire value with another distinct value. What we need for string replace is str dot presumably replace. I don't know what the function is. Let's find it. So runs dot str dot is there a replace? There is a replace. What does it take? It takes a pattern and a replace type. Good part is this works with regular expressions. The bad part is star is a regular expression. So we may have to escape it. No harm in doing that. So let's say backslash star, comma, nothing. So the first one which had a star in it, that star is gone. If I didn't put this str.replace, the first one had 165 not out with a star. With the str.replace, the 165 has gone away and the star has gone away. So I can take this and put this code snippet at the top again. So I've replaced dnb with numpy.nan. I'm replacing the asterisk at the end with nothing. Now let's try and convert it to an int. Does it work? No. It cannot convert a float nan to integer. Those nans that we took, it's treating them as float. And a float, integers do not support nan. Okay, I'm not too fussed about it being an integer. It can be a float. Something 0.0 is fine. Will that work? Not quite. There is, it says I cannot convert this string called abz.
So
is
there, how do I print all distinct values which are not numbers?
How do you think?
Dot distinct.
Dot distinct. Well, I don't know. Let's hold off on that. Value count will certainly work. We just saw that. Any other thoughts?
Unique.
Unique. Let's try. So runs dot dist. No, there isn't anything that starts with dist. So let's ignore that. Runs dot unique. There does appear to be a unique. So if you say runs dot unique, that shows us a bunch of values. Now here we have stuff that ends with star, and we have stuff like TDNB, and we have absent. Now obviously sorting this list and printing it would make more sense, but for now you get a sense that at least absent and TDNB have to be taken care of. One could also say value counts. Runs dot value underscore counts. And that gives me this list, which if I sort, I'm going to put in a function called order. I'm going to explain why order and not sort in the difference. But if I, sort index would work. I sort by index, and I see that there's TDNB and there's absent at the end. So let's account for these two. So I've replaced the star at the end. Let's replace TDNB with numpy.nan and replace absent with numpy.nan and now convert to float. Okay, that seems to work. Let's do that once again. Yep, that's worked fine. So now, at last, we have numeric information on the time, minutes, and the runs. So now we can find out who spent the most time and scored the least. How do we figure that out?
Strike rate. Not strike.
Almost the equivalent metric of that. Let us call it runs per minute. Okay. So runs per minute is effectively number of runs divided by number of minutes. Now, that gives me a bunch of maths.
Some guys got out in the first minute.
Data of runs is all consistently man. Okay, my only problem.
Instead of trying to replace the patterns, why not, you know, cast it into integer, catch the exception, in that case, pass the null.
Which is exactly what I'm going to come to next, to why that is not possible. Okay, bear with me for a few seconds, while I kill a few things that are not required. Now, you remember we had a whole bunch of NANs here, right? The reason was because I kept running this several times. Okay. Now, if it's already an integer, and I start doing stuff like replace DNB with NAN, and backslash stars, string replace this with NAN, and so on. Heaven knows where, but somewhere in the middle of this, it got confused. And said, okay. Like, it did whatever it did. I'm sure it made sense to PyPandas. It doesn't make sense to me right now. But, if you're rerunning stuff, then try and make sure that you start with the same state. But this piece of code is working fine when I just went to the top and pressed shift enter one by one for each one of those. Now it prints the number of runs properly. Which brings us to your question. Why don't we just typecast to int and when it stops in the middle, take an exception and put that as man or something. Let's see how long that takes. Okay, just timing wise, you already got your answer there. Let's add up a bunch of numbers. No, actually, I'm not going to actually do that. I'm going to show you a bunch of benchmarks. Just a bunch of benchmarks on how long stuff takes if you were to do it in a variety of platforms. One of them was comparing NumPy versus Node.js. But okay, let's just do this. Let's run it. What I'm going to do is add up a million numbers. Okay, so that's sum of x range of 1 million. That's whatever number it is. Let's time it. In fact, let's make it 10 million.
Percent 10.
Okay, that took a bit of time. So how long does that take? About 789 milliseconds per loop. Let's do a numpy.a range of 10 million. Okay. Time it. That took 35.9 milliseconds. That's about 20 times faster.
Because, is that because NumPy is in C++? And
C.
C, yeah. So.
And this is NumPy. Yes, that is sort of the simple answer to it. But that's not because Python is just painfully wasting time. Python allows you to, in the middle of this, do stuff like try and catch. It allows you to have all kinds of polymorphism. This x range could be replaced by any function that has an iter, and it would execute that function. And in the middle of this, it will allow you to change that function. NumPy does none of these. It says, you have got to give me an object of exactly the same type. If in the middle it fails, the whole thing fails. There's no exception catching. There's no any other nice features that you want in that you have in Python. But I will give you the features that you really need for processing numbers, so which is the why you can do this. Incidentally, we are about 10 minutes away from the end of the exercise. We haven't even answered the first question. Sorry about that. But you can enjoy the rest of the questions at my leisure. So, let's get to the calculation that we want to do. We wanted to take the number of runs and divide it by the number of minutes. So now we've got a bunch of numbers. Now, they could be inf, that is if the number of minutes was 0. It could be NaN if the number of runs and the number of minutes were 0. We don't care about those. We just want to see who took the max time and scored the least. So let's do minutes by runs. How many minutes per run? And we want to see the max of this.
No, that again.
Now we want to get the max of this. Max is if. Okay, so somebody spent some time not scored any runs. So when you think about it, that will always happen, right? So how does one do that?
Runs greater than 1.
Runs greater than 1.
So let's greater than 0. Sir.
Greater than 0. Fine. Let's do it. So what we do is say greater than, let's say score is equal to data of runs greater than 0. And then I can say among those that score, what is the max? Okay, so somebody spent 82 runs per minute. Most likely they spent 82 minutes scoring 1-1. Okay, now who was this? To figure out, now this brings us to the second way of getting the index. Now let's see if there is an index of this. So if I just say dot index, does it show something? No, unfortunately not. But what I can do is order this. Order is the same as sort. Okay, there's a slight, a subtle distinction. For data frames, you use sort. For series, you use order. The way I remember it is, I try one, if it doesn't work, I try the other. So, now index 18804 is the last one. Now, how do I just get the last item?
Data.ix.
Or something. Okay, data.ix.
Dot last.
Minus one.
Minus one.
Or minus one. Let's try them all one by one. Okay. So let's say this is some series. Series dot tail gives me the last 5 values. I can put a series dot tail of 1 and get the last value. Can I get the last dot last? No, there isn't a dot last. It's tail instead. Dot ix. Now what exactly is this dot ix? I'm not going to cover dot ix. It's very powerful. It's very useful. But I'm not going to. But let's do this. Let's press I for index and press tab and see what all is there. There is something called IDX max and IDX min. Presumably that will be the index of the max and the index min. That's good. There's also an I get. What that does is gets you the index of a specific item. And if, presumably if I say I get of minus 1, it might get me the index of the last one. It doesn't. But you might want to explore something like that. There's a whole bunch of other, or this dot ix, which like I said, I'm not going to explore. Let's go with idx max. And that says 18804. Now, I want the 18804th row. So from data, I need to get that. Let's try data of this one. Not quite. It says here. It says there's no item named 18804. Now, why is that? Remember, we were using data of something for the columns. So we can't use it for the rows as well. By default, data of something refers to the columns, not the rows. So how do I get the rows? Couple of ways of doing it. One is to transpose it. Data.t transposes it. And then I can say data.t of this particular thing. Then I get R.G. Nadkarni, who in 1959 spent 82 minutes hitting 1-1. Which is good. And he did not get out, which is good. Another way of doing it is instead of dot t, you can say dot ix, and dot ix is a very sophisticated way of getting a list of rows. You could get one row, you could get multiple rows, and if I get that result, it's exactly the same. So now we have answered the first question, which is who spent the maximum time and scored the least. Let's go a bit faster. Who hit the most sixes in test cricket? That's an easy one for you. How do you do that?
Some. Found already. It's one inning. Some more for the number of sixes.
Oh, sorry, who hit the maximum sixes?
It's one inning. Single inning.
That is in a single inning. So who hit the most sixes in test cricket? We have to sum it up by. Which brings us to the whole concept of grouping and aggregation and so on. Pandas has this function called group by. I say data dot group by. I'm going to group by player. This assumes that there are no two players with the same name across different countries. There are, but for now we'll assume that there are not.
So
that
is given by some take up and do things.
We can in fact group by multiple keys. That will be next step. So we'll start with the assumption that there's only one player, one name per. You get the idea. Now. This returns a group by object, which is a pretty powerful object in itself. Let's not worry too much about what it does. From this, I can extract just one piece of information. So group by object doesn't actually do anything. It sort of creates a representation and says I'm ready to do whatever other transformations you want. I've created an index by, yeah, actually that's what group by does. Think of it as creation of a database index. And internally it keeps the index ready. Now you can do whatever other database operations you want on this. For example, on this I can say sum everything up. Which, if I put a head, it gets for each player the sum of minutes, sum of runs and sum of sixes. It didn't get the sum of fours. Any guesses why?
Not an int.
It's still a string, so it didn't get that. So now with this, I can just say sort by sixes and get me the head, that gets me the lowest sixes, get me the tape, and I can answer the question straight away. Adam Gilchrist, who was not on our list incidentally. Or I could do this in another way. Dot max dot index. So that's Adam Gilchrist. We have now answered the second question. A little bit faster. Which game had the most runs scored? Now, how do we identify a game?
Which game?
By when you ground them.
Ground.
Date.
Countries.
On the same date, on the same ground, I guess two different. I mean, you'll have only two teams. So when we say which game, do we care about which team in the game? I guess not. So if we just take these two parameters, then we ought to be good. So let's do that. Data dot group by, and here's how.
But test match is over 5 days.
This is fortunately the start date. The column. So we are good. Let's group by start date and the ground. And we want the sum of runs, which obviously we want to sort. Let's sum dot sort runs and get the tail of that. Runs. Okay, so in Durban in 1939, 1894 runs were scored. What? Minutes is 4290. How long is that?
No, you can do it in IPython itself. I should go.
Sorry.
You can do it in IPython.
Good point. And 0 by 60, that's 71 hours. That's not too bad actually. By, let's say, 8 hours of play a day, that's 8 days of play.
From the time
it used to be 6 days earlier.
No, there used to be a time missed.
No, time missed.
Yeah. South Africa was a challenge.
Like till start date is after 1930 or something.
I mean 39.
Yeah, well, let's do that. No, that gets into data processing.
It was
2 minutes. I don't want to do that.
It was a timeless match.
But anyway, so we now have this match in Durban in 1939 that scored 1800 whatever. Who scored the highest percentage of runs?
Is there a match duration column? Number of days.
See, we effectively have that, right? This is the match duration. Total number of minutes of innings.
No.
Each batsman has batted so many minutes.
Correct. Which is not, yeah, which is true. Yeah, but we don't have a separate match score.
So by two.
So
the 1024 numbers actually what they play, not really the time.
Yeah,
this
match
might be wrong.
This might not be a wrong number. Yeah. I mean, 8 days worth of play, adding players' times together.
So yeah, which means it's correct. 8 days.
No,
it's normally 5 days, right?
Yeah.
No.
So,
the two people
playing on either side, right?
Yeah.
So it's twice the number. And also it doesn't take into account stoppages.
No, correct. But see, let us say team A played for 1 day. You would have, let's say, 8 hours of player's time for team A. 8 hours times...
No, it's striker.
Each minute is counted twice.
Striker and non-striker.
Ah, I see.
That's why basically by two.
Okay, by two. Then it's okay. Then it's not bad. 1800 runs though is quite impressive. Let's look at this match. What is the scorecard for this one? So if I say data of start date equals 3rd March 1939. Now, if I wanted to do an AND, it's ampersand, but it's generally good to put brackets or something. Data of
closing bracket.
Yeah, actually, good point. I mean, this maybe in brackets. And data of something else is equal to something else. Close by bracket. This is ground equals the. Okay, so let's see what exactly happened in this match. Make this smaller. Sorry if you can't read it at the back, but I'm quite curious to see what happened. So South Africa versus England, two innings, and somebody scored 200. The opening batsman scored 200.
Chair on the green for 200 minutes.
125, 103. Not too bad actually. So it's not.
It's a timeless test.
But just observe 219 and 140. So, no, just looks like a regular high scoring match, that's all. And it's four innings anyway. So each innings seems to have got what? Around 450 or so. Not too bad then. But they must have been scoring at a pretty fast strike rate to get there. So let's just do the last bit, which is number of ducks. Who scored the maximum ducks? Data of. Data of runs equals zero. Now, will this work?
Group by. You'll have to do a group by player.
That is correct. I can do that after this also.
Okay.
But will data of runs is equal to zero work?
If it did not bat, it will not work.
Yeah, did not bat.
If it did not bat, what did we replace it with?
None.
And zero is not equal to none.
Yes.
So that part is fine. Any other reason why it might not work?
Float.
Asterisk not out.
Float.
Did not score any runs. He batted but did not score any runs.
Batted but did not score any runs, yeah.
No, he didn't.
Therefore,
data
it has to be AND out. He must have gotten out as well. So, data of runs is equal to 0. And data of not out is equal to false. Of course, I could have put this as tilde on that, but let's keep it simple. So, that. Sorry, what? Yes. Which gives us 7,921 innings. 7,921 ducks. Now let's group this by player. Sorry. Yeah. And now instead of summing it up, I can just count. And that gives me a bunch of players. Let's sort them. Or let's just get the runs dot com. Okay, and then order this. Walsh with 43 ducks by a big margin, followed by C.S. Martin, then Glenn McGrath, mostly bowlers. It was entirely bowlers who seemed to be getting out of duck. Understandable, sir. But to Courtney Walsh goes the credit. Let me stop there. What I want to do was give you a sense of how what Pandas feels like. Hope you got that sense. Also want to give you a sense of how you discover stuff in Python, in IPython specifically for Pandas, by just pressing dot and tab and play around there. Pandas documentation is decent. I would strongly suggest going through the document, spending the time and effort to going through Pandas documentation in full. Will take a while, but suggest doing that. It's got great time series functionality. It's got great aggregation functionality. The index is extraordinarily powerful. We haven't touched upon the index. You can merge across multiple data sets very, very well. And lots more. And it's got a good, strong, growing community. Plus, it's Python, so which means you get to benefit all the other stuff in Python. So let me stop there. We probably don't have time for questions.
Yeah.
Okay, let's take a few questions.
A lot of continuous products are not LGPL. So how does Pandas figure on that? Any
so
ideas?
The continuum distribution of Pandas may not be LGPL, but Pandas itself is whatever license it is and is liberal.
So if I don't go the route of doing a Anaconda install, and just do a pip install?
You should
Pandas
be fine. Yeah. You can't quite do a pip install. You can, well, on Linux you can.
Yeah.
On Windows you may not be able to.
Mac works.
So I think we didn't have enough time, but I want to know if there is anything very powerful about Pandas, because a lot of these things can be done with MySQL or any relational data representation. even Excel. So I just want to just talk one thought.
Firstly, it's programmatic.
Yeah.
So that helps. Secondly, it's a question of programming language of choice. Okay. So if you say, if I did this in R, how easy would it be? Probably just as easy. Assuming you know R.
I guess if
the sum was very slow, particularly when you did the sum, right? On 80,000 rows, it seemed slow. I mean, it took a little second.
So I'm doing it the most inefficient way possible. What I would have done is done the filtering once and then done the group by, or done the group by first and then the filtering, rather than doing both simultaneously. And yes, pandas can be slow if used inefficiently, same as any database would have been, yes. But in terms of raw speed, it rivals practically every platform. On R, for instance, on average, I find that pandas is about twice to thrice as fast compared to R. Compared to raw C code, depending on how you write the code, pandas is about 1.2x. So compared to Node.js, is about 30-40% faster. Compared to most platforms, short of handling your own C code, pandas is still faster and is improving. So speed is certainly one advantage. The other advantage is simply that it is in Python. So if you happen to, I'll put it this way, if you are already using Python, then there is no doubt. If you're not using Python, then I wouldn't suggest learning pandas for the sake learning Python for the sake of pandas.
But as far as performance goes, you know, taking this in a Python script and from, you know, putting it through something like PyPy, it should give performance enhancements anyway, right?
Not quite. Pandas is C-based, so PyPy is a bit of a problem. So if you took raw Python code, put it into PyPy, yes, you'll get that kind of optimization. You wouldn't get it as fast as pandas in the first place.
Because anyways, using NumPy,
exactly.
Can it work with like live streaming data?
As long as you get the live streaming data to come. What kind of live streaming data are you talking about?
As in Twitter. Anything that's continuous, as in like in this example you used to CSV, right? Like can you like run all these queries on a stream of data that's constantly incoming?
Will you ask the question, how will the stream come?
Can it wait for data like a Mongo river?
You can set it up that way. Pandas itself takes a fixed constant chunk. So you need something in front that takes whatever stream that comes in and breaks it up into chunks. That is one half of the answer. The other half of the answer is pandas itself, actually the read frame can take chunks. It does support it. When you load a file, you can tell it, I want to read it as multiple chunks because there's no point in holding. Supposing you were adding a bunch of numbers. You don't have to load the whole thing into memory. Just load every 10 megabytes or 100 megabytes and process it and then move on. So you can tell it to read it in chunks, but it requires a little bit of front-end engineering to make sure the stream passes through to it seamlessly. That is how you would do it with the more recent versions of pandas.
How about charting? Can it plot histograms?
Yes, IPython can. Pandas supports IPython. Why would you bother? Meaning, between R and D3, you've got much better capabilities. And IPython plotting would work in an IPython environment. If you want to package an application and send it through there, I guess you could. Don't.
Native JSON
environment? Yeah, Python has native JSON. So, and the native JSON parser in Python is extremely fast.
So, you can just take JSON object directly in pandas instead of doing a read CSV.
Exactly.
Is it meant for any kind of distributed
like
multiple server data aggregated
to process? If you are on a single server trying multi threading or multi processing, then Python has a known problem with that, which is a global interface. If you're doing it on multiple systems, then the overhead of splitting the data and splitting the processes is on you, the same as any other Python program. So pandas does not provide any extra support for it.
I think it's simple enough for a lot of ad hoc processing, right? Like log processing. But let's say if you have logs on three different machines and you quickly want to do some of something.
You don't want to use pandas for that. That's like using a sledgehammer for adding up. What I would use for that is awk.
Yeah, but it's across three servers.
Three awks, add it up and do a simple map reduce. But, and the way I do simple map reduce is by having three different awks running and then adding up with a BC or something. I mean, ultimately, that's all it is. So now pandas would be too heavy solution for that. You don't want to use pandas for adding up maps.
Cool, so let's wrap it up.
Thank you, folks. Thank you.